إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم.
صدقكم الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, first and foremost I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all seated here to adopt a life of taqwa, a life filled with the fear and consciousness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a true believer achieve success in this world and the hereafter. Now moving on, the title of today's khutbah inshaAllah is going to be the perfect love story. Not because of the fact that today is the 14th of February and that this day is celebrated all around the world as Valentine's Day or the festival of love or whatever you may call it. For a true believer, for a true mu'min would never ever celebrate this day. He would never celebrate Valentine's Day. For it stems, the roots of this day stem from paganic cultures. And likewise, this very day promotes illicit relationships. In other words, open zina, which is tantamount to incurring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from his wrath, his ghadab and his punishment. Nor am I going to waste my time speaking about a particular love story like Romeo and Juliet or Layla and Majnun or any other story for that matter. Today's khutbah is going to evolve around the most purest form of love. In other words, love at the pinnacle of its purity. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, love gives life to a human heart. Love gives life to a human soul. For without love, the heart is dead. Without love, the soul is dead. But sadly today we live in a world where tables have turned. The scales of balance have been disrupted by us human beings. Today love has become a taboo subject. The word love, the minute it crosses our minds, the first thing that comes to our minds is the relationship, the illicit relationship between a man and a woman. No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we are talking about loving the source of love. The source of love. the creator of love, from whom love began. And that is none other than our powerful Almighty Maker Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For this, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most pure and the most noblest form of love. Allahu Akbar. Look at the golden words of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, who says that the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is divided into three stages. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is divided into three stages. Stage number one, to love Allah. Stage number one, to love Allah. Stage number two, to love something or someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To love something or someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the final stage, which is the worst of stages, is to love something alongside or along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the three primary stages. Now the first stage, it divides itself into another three stages. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divides itself into three stages. The first one being the pure love that sprouts due to one recognizing the manifestation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stands around him. Allahu Akbar. I say this often, that we, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we are indeed wallowing in an ocean of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From the very day we were born, even whilst we were in the wombs of our mothers, Allah the Almighty, our beloved Maker, He fashioned us within three veils of darkness. He gave us such beautiful limbs. Today we walk, we talk, we hear, we do every single thing. The basis or the virtue of our own parents, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in their hearts, love towards us so that they looked after us. They brought us to what we are today. Every single thing. If you were to look around, all of these things are blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we were to try and enumerate these favors, we would fail miserably. Likewise, if we were to fall in sajda, prostration, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our complete, for our whole lives, even that would not be sufficient, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So if we were to look around at these signs and recognize our Creator, the pure love, the sprout, that is stage number one. Now how would this love sprout? Number one, we could look around at the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this love would sprout. Likewise, stage number two, that we ponder and reflect on the words of our noble Maker. Today, we weak believers, we look at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the speech of our beloved Maker. Even if we were to start a chapter, we are hoping, when is the chapter going to end? We are flipping pages, hoping that the chapter would end soon. How many more pages for the chapter or the juz to end? How many more pages for the surah to end? Now, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us in the noble Quran. Allah says,
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
Allah uses the word أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Allah did not say أَفَلَا يَسْمَعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, أَفَلَا يَقْرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. No.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
Do you not ponder? تدبر. Do you not reflect on the verses of the noble Quran?
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Do you not ponder on the verses of the noble Quran, on the speech of your beloved Maker?
أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا.
Or have you got locks that have locked your heart, that have hardened your heart, that you cannot ponder and reflect on the verses of the noble Quran? In another place of God the Almighty, He says,
كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ.
Allahu Akbar. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. A book
We have sent it down. A revelation. We have sent it down as what? Mubarak. As a blessing. So how would this book be a blessing, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? Allah goes on to say,
كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ.
لام التعليل في Arabic language لِيَدَّبَّرُوا. The law for a reason. Allah says, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. A revelation that has been sent down as a blessing. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا. So that you all may reflect once again. Not that you all may recite. Not that you all may flick through the pages so that the chapter ends. No. So that you all may reflect. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. So that you may reflect on its verses. وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And likewise, people of intellect, so that they may remind themselves. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Stage number two, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is to ponder on the words of our beloved Maker. For how can we love someone if we do not know about that person? How can we love someone if we do not know about that person? So how are we going to recognize our Creator other than if we do not ponder on the verses of our beloved Maker, likewise in the creation, likewise his signs, his favors, his bounties that are all manifesting themselves around us. So these two stages, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, to identify our Creator and, you know, bring in the pure love that we have for him. To know more about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, naturally we have to refer back to his own words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about himself, he says,
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ.
Allah says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Look at how merciful, how beloved he is to us, my respected elders and brothers in Islam.
يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا. Oh my beloved slaves. يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا. Those slaves of mine, أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ,
who have transgressed the limit in regard to their own selves. أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ.
لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ.
الله أكبر. You know, giving up hope on our own selves, that is the biggest crime that we can do.
لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ.
Do not despair. Do not give hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For indeed, He is the most merciful.
إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا.
Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He would forgive all of your sins.
إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
For indeed, He is the most forgiving, most merciful.
He's the most forgiving, the most merciful.
Even if we were to go to him with sins amounting to the oceans and the mountains, Allah the Almighty, he's so merciful, he's so forgiving, that he would forgive all of that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam.
Never give up hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Never despair, for we belong to a powerful Maker who never ever grows tired of forgiving his beloved slaves.
He never grows weary of giving his slaves a second chance.
Allah is waiting for us to turn to him. Let me share with you all a story. A story of a Sahabi, radiallahu anhu. His name was Abu Lubaba. This story is mentioned by the scholars of Tafsir. They mention this story under the ayah, under the sabab al-nuzul, or the reason of revelation behind the ayah.
Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la takhunu Allaha wa rasula wa takhunu amanatikum wa antum ta'lamun.
O you who believe, la takhunu Allaha wa rasul. Do not try to deceive Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his beloved messenger. Wa takhunu amanatikum wa antum ta'lamun. Likewise, do not deceive those things that have been entrusted to you, ya amana, wa antum ta'lamun, whilst you are aware. After this ayah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this story is mentioned, this narration. His name was Abu Lubaba. This happened right after the Battle of Khandaq.
the battle of the trench.
Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to protect Medina, he dug a trench around Medina. Around Medina, a trench was dug. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed the Banu Qurayza, they were a tribe, a Jewish tribe. He placed them, there was a contract, an agreement between them and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they would protect Medina from behind Banu Qurayza. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed them behind Medina to protect the women folk and the children who were inside Medina. While the Sahaba radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhi majma'in were in the forefront, fighting or fending off the kuffar by the trenches. Now what happened? Banu Qurayza, they breached that agreement. They breached the agreement, letting a few kuffar slip through the barracks from behind to attack the women folk. Now this was a breach of trust, a breach of contract. So what happened after the battle? They took refuge in a particular fortress. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Muslim army besieged them for almost a month. 1 month they were besieged in this fortress. So after 1 month, their supply of food ran short. They were starving. And now they come up for negotiation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sends an ambassador to negotiate. His name was Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, a great Sahabi indeed. Abu Lubaba, he goes to Banu Qurayza. Now they knew of Abu Lubaba from before. They trusted him. The Banu Qurayza, they trusted him because they had dealings with him. They knew Abu Lubaba. And that is one of the reasons why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Abu Lubaba. Abu Lubaba goes to Banu Qurayza and he advises them exactly what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had asked him to do. He says, you better come out from the fortress and submit to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is my advice to you all. So what happened? Banu Qurayza, as they knew Abu Lubaba, they asked him after he conveys the message, Abu Lubaba, Ya Aba Lubaba. Now all the women come out of the fortress and they say, Ya Aba Lubaba, tell us what you really think that we should do. Tell us what you really think that we should do. And you have brought us the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but tell us what you really think that we should do. Abu Lubaba, he does not utter a word, but what he said, he does this. He signals, as for the people who cannot see me, he signals by moving his hand across his throat, signifying death. You come out, it's going to be murder. They are going to kill you. This is what he signals. He comes out of the fortress. Now by him doing that, the tiny action of his caused a lot of fitna amongst the Banu Qurayza. Now this was something that he was not entrusted to do so. He was the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had no right whatsoever to do what he did. So he comes out of the fortress and he starts to regret. Even though he was the only Muslim who went in, nobody else saw his action in moving his hand across his throat. But he comes out and he begins to regret that he deceived Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He begins to regret. He runs to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to Masjid al-Nabawi. There were pillars like these pillars. Known as Sariya or Istiwala in the Arabic language. He rushes to one of the pillars, he ties himself up on one of the pillars, and he announces, I have committed a crime, and until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down an ayah or a decree that he is forgiving me, only then will I untie myself from the pillar. The news goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, Abu Lubaba, he could have come to me and confessed what he did. And I would have asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I would have sought forgiveness for him and Allah would have forgiven him. But now that he is waiting for the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let us wait and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to do. Now look at this story, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. They did not give up hope. They did not despair of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He waits by the pillar, tied up. His wife used to come for the time of salawat and untie him. He used to make the salah, go back and tie himself up, waiting for the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason being, he did not give up hope on Allah. He did not despair of the mercy
كرامه الله سبحانه وتعالى. He knew that Allah is غفور, Allah is رحيم, and this is the reason why we need to be delving into the science of the glorious names and attributes of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. There is a science that has been forgotten today. The reason being, we cannot now identify the greatness of our Creator. We cannot identify, unless and of course if we study His glorious name, His attributes, His sifat, only then will we know the greatness of our Creator, to love Him more and more. Abu Lubaba, Sayyidah, radiallahu anhu, by the pillar, six nights fast. The seventh morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wakes up at the time of Sahar. He wakes up smiling. If I'm not mistaken, it is Salama radiallahu anha who was with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is it that you wake up with such a beautiful smile? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, glad tidings be to Abu Lubaba. Let glad tidings be to Abu Lubaba. For indeed Allah the Almighty has sent down an ayah in regard to him. Salama radiallahu anha was also excited. She said, Ya Rasulullah, can I go and convey the good news to Abu Lubaba? This was before the command of Hijab had come down. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, go and give him glad tidings. Salama radiallahu anha, she goes and informs Abu Lubaba about the ayah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recites the ayah. وَآخَرُونَ اعْتَرَفُوا بِذُنُوبِهِمْ خَلَتُوا عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَآخَرَ سَيِّئًا عَسَى اللَّهُ أَنْ يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ وَآخَرُونَ اعْتَرَفُوا بِذُنُوبِهِمْ. And they are those who acknowledge their sins. They have confessed their sins. وآخرون اعترفوا بذنوبهم خلطوا عملا صالحا وآخر سيئا. They have mixed up a good deed with a bad deed, with an evil deed. He goes as the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but does something else, something contrary to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered him to do. And Allah goes on to say, عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ. And indeed, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Indeed, Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. Salama radiallahu anha, she rushes to inform Abu Lubaba. And she asks him, one of the Sahaba who was around him, they asked him, shall we untie you now? The decree of Allah has come. Abu Lubaba says, no, I want Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself to come and untie me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he comes to Salat al-Fajr, he unties Abu Lubaba. This story, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is just to highlight that it is not up to us to give up hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For whatever we do, it is upon us to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in tawbah. For Allah is the most forgiving, the most merciful. The third and final stage of the love of Allah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the peak. It is known as Martabatul Khulla. Now this peak, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, none has reached it other than Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this stage is to free your heart from any other object of love other than Allah the Almighty. This is the highest stage. This is the pinnacle in mahabba. This is the pinnacle in love, to free your heart from every single object other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that one of the secrets behind why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam to sacrifice his own son was a trial and a test, to test his love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether his son had become an object of love that would replace the love of Allah in his heart. But he passed that test with flying colors, where he was ready to sacrifice his own son to prove the true love that he had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The pure love that he had for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just a few more minutes into the next stage, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, from the primary stages, and that is to love something or someone for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that stage, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is reserved for the love of our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. The ayah recited in the beginning, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. If you love, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, tell the Sahaba, tell the Muslimun, if you love Allah, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is supposed to say, this is the command of Allah, that you are to follow me, follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يُعْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهِ, and in return Allah will love you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, and Allah will forgive all of your sins, وَإِنَّهُ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. And see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, most merciful. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if we go through the narration, the talk about the beauty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is all upon us to study. We need to study history, study the seerah, study about our beloved master. Every single narration talks about his good conduct, his physical appearance, all of which would fill our hearts with love for him. Today, sadly, we suffer complexes to look like him. We suffer complexes to follow him. Whilst in reality, his lifestyle is the lifestyle that would give us success in this world and the hereafter. Allah the Almighty, when he talks about his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the noble Quran, in regard to his sound intellect, Allah says, مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that indeed your companion, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا غَوَى, he has not been misguided, وَمَا غَوَى, nor is he in a delusional state. In regard to his perfect sight, Allah says, مَا زَاغَ الْبَطَرُ وَمَا تَغَى, that his eyesight, it does not transgress any limit. It is the most perfect of eyesight. In regard to his broad-mindedness, Allah says, أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. Are we not the ones who open your chest for you, O Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? In regard to his high mention, Allah says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. And it is we, Allah is saying, it is we who raised your mention, raised you in your remembrance. In regard to his integrity, Allah says, وَلَا يَنْتِقْوَا لِلْهَوَى. He does not speak out of his own pocket. He does not speak out of his own desires. Whatever he speaks, in huwa illa wahyun yuha. All of it is divine inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In regard to the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, allamahu shadeedul quwa. It was Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam who was his teacher, Allahu Akbar, who told Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in totality Allah the Almighty, he kept it off by saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And indeed, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are of a great moral character, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, the most perfect human being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. A few anecdotes that highlight the love that the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in had for our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, one fine day he was walking towards the masjid. He was on the road walking to the masjid. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid, he cries out, Ya ayyuhan nas ijlisu. Oh people, sit down. Rasulullah is addressing the congregation at large. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu is outside. He hears the words of his master, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He immediately sits in the middle of the street. In the middle of the street. People around him ask him, Ibn Mas'ud, what is wrong with you? Why are you sitting in the middle of the street? He says, I heard the command of my master, and how dare I disobey him in any situation. Allahu Akbar. This is the love that they have, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Umar radiallahu anhu, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was passing, I think if I'm not mistaken, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu's house. He was passing by, there was a pipe that was jutting out where the water in the rooftop used to get collected and flow down. A few drops of water or a few drops of blood
came down the pipe and started on his dress. Umar رضي الله عنه was so angry, he looked at the pipe and broke it off from that house. He broke it off from that house. And he goes to the masjid for Salah. After Salah, Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه gets up and says, with a bit of anger, who is the one who broke the pipe of my house? Who is the one who broke the pipe of my house? Umar رضي الله عنه says, I did it. I broke the pipe of your house, the reason being you're causing harm to the people who pass by on the street. There was water or a few drops of blood that was flowing through it. Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنه explained, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, forgive me. The reason being I think I had sacrificed an animal on the rooftop and perhaps the blood was flowing through that particular pipe. But I was upset that you broke the pipe because it was not I who put the pipe. When I was building my house, it was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who came and placed the pipe with his own blessed hand. Umar radiallahu anhu started to cry. He started to weep. He said, Ibn Abbas, you sit on my back and let me carry you back there and let us fix it exactly the way our master had kept it. Allahu Akbar. This is the love that they had. The Kuffar, they approached Hassan ibn Thabit. Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu before he embraced Islam. They tell him he was a great poet. He was a great poet. They tell him, oh Hassan, go, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be by the market area or somewhere there. Go and disgrace him. Use your poetry to disgrace him. They gave him a big sum of money to Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu. Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, he accepts the offer. He goes to the marketplace waiting for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to disgrace him using words of poetry. While he was waiting, finally Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes. Now he was concocting and, you know, brainstorming on how he is going to disgrace Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The minute he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was shocked. He was astounded. He knew that, you know, he was tongue-tied. Words were coming because of the beauty, because of how handsome Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was. There was not one defect that he could highlight or point out. He was amazed. Then he thought, okay, let me blemish his character. There must be something in his conduct that I can touch on. Let me follow him, and he follows Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his house. Allahu Akbar. But while he's going home, there is nothing in the conduct of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he could point out. Why? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was giving salam to people. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. He was helping people, helping elderly people, giving charity. This was the life of our master, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Finally, Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu returns back to the kuffar and gives them the bag of money. Here's what you gave me. I don't want to be part of you. The kuffar, they say, why has? Woe be unto you. Did we not entrust you with something? Did we not give you a mission to undertake? Why did you come back dejected? And why are you returning the money? Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, he says, let me tell you something. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. And he goes on praising Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in beautiful words of poetry, leaving the kuffar ashamed and dejected. Allahu Akbar. Finally, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I leave you all with the story of the love of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu that he had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is an amazing narration, my dear respected elders and brothers of Islam. Many scholars of history have mentioned this narration. Hassan ibn Bilal radiallahu anhu, after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he could not bear it because every single thing that was around Medina was reminding him of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he leaves Medina. He could not bear it. Every single thing, every path, every doorway, every house, every person was reminding him of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the love that he had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He leaves Medina and goes towards Sham. He goes towards Sham. He stays there for some time. And then one day he sees a dream where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in that dream. And then Bilal radiallahu anhu intends to visit Medina. He goes to Medina, and the minute Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sees Bilal radiallahu anhu, the first thing that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asks him, Ya Bilal, please call out the Adhan. Please call out the Adhan.
بلال رضي الله عنه says, apologies, أمير المؤمنين. I cannot bring myself to call out the Adhan because I would remember Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I cannot do it. Please don't ask me to do it. He goes past the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hassan Hussein radiallahu anhuma. Sajjidah shabab ahlul jannah. Those two youngsters, the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, come out running and hug him. He smells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he hugs them. And they plead, Ya Bilal, please call out the Adhan just once. Please call out the Adhan just once. Bilal radiallahu anhu. Now it is the request of the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He loves them so much. He cannot refuse. He agrees. He climbs the place, the pulpit or the minar where you are supposed to call out the Adhan. And he starts calling out the Adhan. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. He calls out the Adhan. Bilal radiallahu anhu. He calls out the Adhan. The people of Medina come running out. Has Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come back? Has Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come back? The women of Medina come running out. Bilal radiallahu anhu goes on. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. He calls out the Adhan. The people leave the market. The women leave their homes. The children all come running to the masjid. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam come back, our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes on with the Adhan, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. He reaches the point. Ashhadu an la Muhammad Rasulullah. The minute he mentions his beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's name, he's shook, he starts weeping, he starts crying, he cannot continue with the adhan. Allahu Akbar. The Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, all of them are weeping. The women of Medina are crying. The nuggets can be heard. Is Rasulullah back? Can we see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Bilal radiallahu anhu descends from where he was calling the adhan because he could not continue the adhan. This was the love that they had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. The narrator of the story, of the narration, he says, On that day, the day Bilal radiallahu anhu called out the Adhan, the cries of Medina, the weeping of Medina was so great. Every single person was crying. It was such a sad day that there was no other day similar to that day in history other than the day where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. These 2 days were the most darkest of days for the Sahaba radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhim ajma'in because of their sincere and true love that they had for our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So may we respect the elders and brothers in Islam. It is upon us not to waste our lives over trivial, petty issues, but rather focus on Akhirah. Focus on Akhirah. Inculcate the love of our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inculcate the love of our beloved Maker. For it is only through this pure love can we attain success in this world and the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill all our hearts with pure love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He fill our hearts with pure love for our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may He give us the strength to adopt His lifestyle as our lifestyle. May He make us true believers, strong believers on the straight path towards Deen, towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May He forgive all of our sins.